Hi everyone, and I'm joined by Karan Oberoi right now. Hi Karan, thank you so much for doing this.
Hi Diksha, hi. Yep. You're welcome.
How long has it been ever since you came out?
I think it's about a week or so. It's been a week, yeah.
How is it sinking in right now?
It's still not all there in the sense I'm still in a state of some sort of a shock, and I've not gotten back to my routine. I'm still not sleeping too well, eating too well.
And like, the support that's come your way has been immense. So what has the take of your family, your friends, has been like in all of this?
I think they were my rock of Gibraltars, to be honest. And I always tell people that I hope everyone in the world is as fortunate to have somebody like a Pooja Bedi in their life, a friend that stands through very, very trying and testing times. And especially in cases like that, you know, by and large, most people do not want to stand next to you because... I was one of the very, very few blessed ones that I had an overwhelming support, not from my family, just from my family, my friends, everyone that I'd even met remotely once or in passing for the last 15-20 years.
Do you personally ever feel that I should take a step back from all of this and think of whatever's gone down? Like, should I have done things differently?
There is when you do something, then you think of things differently. When you don't do something, then you're only wondering as to what went wrong. How could this turn out to be this way? Mm-hmm. Because if it can happen to me, it can happen to any human being on the planet. Who's safe? And my story was one, but within the jail premises there were 600 other stories of people who were suffering a lot more than I am. I was fortunate that I had the support of so many people, but they are voiceless, nameless people. They don't have the money or the media support or the whereabout to be able to exonerate themselves from this.
So, are you saying a lot of people are in the jail for no fault of theirs?
Yes. Yes, that's exactly what I'm saying. So as per the NHRC survey, I read somewhere that 50% of the cases in this sort of a case are fake, 50%. And there are another 20-25% that are settled out of court. So it's almost become a tool of vendetta or manipulation or extortion. And those cases were there in the prison where people were suffering and they didn't have anyone to kind of support them.
And in all of this, what we have seen is also Men Too. Me Too came out. There were so many women who were talking about their experiences. And with Men Too, do you think the terminology could have been different? And what is your take on Men Too? Because you're the poster boy for it.
I think Me Too was one of the most wonderful movement because it brought about the stories that were not told, and it also acts as a deterrent to the men in power. I had written a massive, very strongly worded blog supporting Me Too, and unfortunately, I was also a victim of Me Too as a boy. I've been a feminist all my life. I've believed in the power of expression, and I believe that in complete equality. As far as Men Too is concerned, you have to understand, Men Too is not. It's Men Too versus Me Too. Mm. When you talk about justice, it's justice for all. And that's what justice represents by definition. You're saying no man, woman or animal should be incarcerated for something that they haven't done. Mm. When someone's heart breaks or when they're crying and howling at a certain pitch, you don't even know it's a male voice or a female voice. You can only understand, empathize with the pain that they're going through. And we cannot. I know there's been 5,000 years of patriarchy. I think, yes, women have not been treated very... History hasn't treated women kindly. But yes, there are men like me, and there are many men like me that believe that we need to fight for men and for women. I can't be carrying the burden of 5,000 years of patriarchy and suffering for something that I haven't done. You know, sometimes when you meet someone and you talk to them, you get a sense of saying whether they're speaking the truth or not. The criminal there would look at me and saying, you know, Karan bhai, we are criminals. We can identify someone that's done something from a mile away. So they were the ones who put me in touch with those boys who were suffering. And when I spoke to their stories and I saw their tears in their eyes, it was evident that they were not there because they'd done something. The system was being manipulated and the law was being manipulated for settling personal vendetta scores.
Cases that came out in the last year before that, a lot of times lines are blurred. So do you think there were any red flags for you?
I don't know if any, lines could be blurred because it's a he said, she said sort of a situation. But, you know, between friends you have misunderstandings, between couples you have misunderstandings, between marriages you have misunderstanding. But you still have to speak the truth. You have to represent the truth for what it is. Because I don't like you or I don't get along with you cannot be the reason for me to use the biggest, biggest, most heinous thing that happens to human beings. Mm. Use that as a tool to destroy a life. Mm. I'm completely for death penalty for rape, rapists, proven rapists. But don't use that as an equation to incarcerate and make somebody else suffer. A relationship not working out, a friendship not working out, a misunderstanding cannot be termed rape. It is the most heinous thing in the world.
In terms of future collaborations, do you think this is going to have an impact on what you could do?
When something breaks your heart, you create art. So there is a song that I've already written, which I'm going to be releasing very soon. But it doesn't talk about, I don't look at life. I've always looked at life from rose-tinted glasses. And my experience in jail, because of the fact that I had too many people that were holding me with baby gloves in the cell, in my cellmates and outside. Mm-hmm. I have no reason to be bitter or angry. So my expression shall be, will be positive and uplifting for society.
Any particular learning that's come off from?
Yeah, from this nightmare. One of the things that I realize is that I can be slightly strong in the way I want to say things. I'm very soft by nature, because of which I could have taken a stronger stand. Instead of I could have said, hey, and not using profanities, but still said, I could have. So that is something, that is a lesson that I've learned, that if I don't agree with you, I'm sorry, I don't agree with you, go away. Because it carried on for too long, and I should have been very strong. I was just being too much of a gentleman and too polite and decent and saying, God bless, take care, God bless, take care, God bless, take care. Some people don't understand that.
Thank you so much for speaking with us, Karan.